In their Christmas catalog for 1961, the American electronics vendor Radio Shack offered a unique tape recorder under its house brand name, Realsitc. The machine was unique to the vendor because it was made by Robuk Electrical Industries of London, England. The two-track high-fidelity monophonic tape recorder featured a three-motor transport with three speeds, sound-on-sound, and sound-with-sound capability, housed in a stylish two-tone fabric-covered wood case. Radio Shack labeled it Realsitc by Robuk, and it sold for a limited time. By 1963, it was gone. 54 years later, in 2016, a Realsitc by Robuk tape recorder appeared on eBay. Recognizing the unique rarity and audiophile value of the machine, ClydeSight purchased it for historical preservation. Welcome to the Christmas Tape Recorder. This video series is a documentary of the arrival, exploration, and restoration of this rarely seen or heard unique consumer-grade tape recorder. This is the Realsitc Robuk tape recorder, the way it arrived at ClydeSight. It's a very attractive machine from the time period, and it has the famous two-tone case from that time period, where we have the lighter tone and then a band of dark color, which is a kind of red. It's sort of a brick red, and then the top color is repeated on the bottom, and there's piping to separate the two of them. It also has these nice brass accents. And here is some cream-colored plastic for the handle, which wraps around a steel band. And so it has enough strength to hold the weight. The machine weighs about 28 pounds. What we're going to do in this episode of the series is examine the machine, the way it has arrived, look for cosmetic issues, mechanical issues, and electrical issues. So we will be doing a full test of the tape recorder in this episode. So we've seen the front of the tape recorder. Let's take a look at the side. The side view shows more of the nice design. This is a brass catch for the lid. It needs to be polished. Here we see the speaker. The grill is dirty. Hopefully I can clean that up when I clean up the case. The grill has a sort of a, I guess it's an escutcheon or a bezel made out of a brass kind of material. It's probably plated. A little bit of a ding here and there. Some of these things are just the result of age and use, so they probably are like scars that people have as they go through life. It just shows the thing was used and it was cared about because it was used. Let's take a look at the back. Looking at the back, we can see that there are some issues. The feet that belong here are missing. Here are the upper feet. They're in good shape. They're here. They're going to have to be replaced. There's a slot here for ventilation, another ventilation slot. This is an interesting component here. What it is a circuit board that is a jumper, and it allows for the voltage to be regulated. So the plug that we see sticking out here is the actual jumper. And there are three holes on the board. If these two holes are connected, one and two, then it will run 100 volts to 110 volts. If these two are connected here and here, then it runs 110 to 120 volts. This is the correct setting for my area because my area is supposed to have 117 volts on average. We also see here is a door for a compartment. Now, it should have a handle here, which is just a simple cylinder, but it's not there. But I'll try and open it up with my thumb. See, the screw broke off, so getting this open is not easy. And it reveals that there is a microphone in here, as well as a power cord. And we'll look at those later on when we test the machine. So right now we just wanted to see the condition. We have brass hinges here. Just need a little bit of cleaning and they'll be ready to go. Let's take a look at the other side. We see the nice two-tone design obviously continues around. There's a gap here in the piping. That's probably caused by plastic shrinkage. I'm going to have to come up with a solution for that. And here we have the audio controls. At the top, we see a switch that is on or off. When it's forward, it is on. When it is towards the back, it is off. It's a simple rocker switch. Then we have a potentiometer for monitor. This is for tone. This is for gram gain. And what does gram gain mean? Well, because this is a British tape recorder, the gram stands for gramophone. And at the time period, people would make recordings from the gramophone, which is the British way of saying record player. And then down below here, we have the volume control. We also have our input and outputs. Here we have the microphone input. We have the gram input. That is your line input, basically recording from a phonograph or a gramophone. And this volume control controls that. This volume control controls the microphone, which means you can mix sound with sound. We have here an external amplifier output. So that's your line output. So basically the two white things are your line input and your line output. And then this is the black one is your microphone input. And the black one here is for an external speaker. They call it external LS, which stands for external loud speaker. The monitor volume controls when you have the line input so that you can hear what is going into the line input. You would use the monitor for that. And it's interesting that it has little colored plastic inserts on these RCA jacks. Let's take a look now at the bottom. Now we're seeing some issues that are pretty serious because we have two plastic grills here that have been severely damaged. Especially this one, it's got holes in it. I knew that this was going to be the case because the seller had put up photographs of it when I bought it on eBay. So it doesn't surprise me, and I have some ideas on how I'm going to restore this. There's also a sign here that says Made in England, so we know that it's a British tape recorder. And there's been some damage to it here. This is a tough cloth, but it wasn't tough enough for whatever happened to it here, which may have also caused this damage. We also see these little plastic feet again, and one of them has either broken off or been taken off and replaced with this black rubber foot. So we're going to have to balance all of this out. So that's the cosmetic condition of the tape recorder. Nothing unusual, considering the fact that this is almost 54 years old. I'm estimating this was built in 1961 or 1962. It's a pretty color, and it's a heavy machine, but it also has quite a few interesting features. The Realsitc Robuk tape recorder is very easy to work with. You open the lid, and we can see that it's got a nice hinge on it that lets it open up freely. Now, it's a half hinge, so the lid will come off. And here we see the lid off. There's the half hinge. You can see it right there. And the color is very good on the inside of the lid, which indicates to me that when we compare the color and flip it over, you can see here's the color on the outside. And then we look on the inside, it's almost exactly the same. Now, that's important because if this had a problem with color fading, we would have seen a different color on the inside than we do on the outside. But this is not the case, so this is in very good shape. The controls are stop, which is a red key, rewind, fast forward, play, and record. Normally, you would expect red to be record and a different color for stop. But that's not how they did it. Now, to press the record button, you can't. And that's because you have to press this little button here. That's your record interlock. When you press it down, then you can push down the record button. And you notice that as soon as that got pushed down, the pause control came out of its little hiding place. Watch the pause control go in when I press stop. So I'll go back, this time I'll press play. Obviously there's no power to the machine yet. And then I'll pull the pause with my finger. There are no reel tables, there are reel spindles here and here. And reels are held by these lockdown, which are screw lockdowns. So I'll unscrew that. You see that? And I'll do this one. It looks almost like a cartridge recorder. Here we have a 3-digit tape counter. It's a sideways tape counter, so this is the lowest digits will run first, and then the upper digits will run after that. Head cover, and here we have the name Realsitc by Robuk. And then here we have a very interesting button, and it's called Superimpose. There's another new feature specialized for this machine. And what it does is it disengages the erase head under here. When that's disengaged, we then have sound on sound. So this machine is capable of sound with sound and sound on sound. And here we have a 3-position speed switch. 7.5, 3.75, 1 7/8. And there is a indicator here that says speed change. Up here is a magic eye tube that says level. And this is one of those magic eye tubes where you have blue on each end and an empty space in the middle, and the gap gets bigger or smaller depending on the amount of volume being picked up. The speed control is very easy to turn right now because it's actually disengaged when the machine is in stop. I've looked at, there's a schematic for this machine online. I got one, and it's not a full schematic, but it was enough to indicate how the mechanics of this are laid out. And there is actually an idler between the motor that runs the capstan, which is over here. That's the capstan is underneath here. And the motor is over here somewhere. And there's an idler that goes between the two of them, and this controls the idler. This is a 3-motor machine. There's a motor for the rewind, a motor for the fast forward. So now we see all the controls. Let's find out if it can actually work. So to do that, I got to get the power cord out. The power cord, which came with the machine, has this very unusual plug. It's got a gripper here, so when you grab it and pull it, it's easy to grab and pull so you don't pull on the wire to get this disengaged from the plug. Unfortunately, it got some damage to it, as you can see here. And I thought, oh, maybe there's a short or something. But when I looked inside, and it's a little hard to tell here, the wiring goes straight on through. There's a, underneath this screw, there is a clamp, and then here are the two prongs for the power. And the wire is screwed to both of them. So this is a, in spite of the fact that there's some damage to the sleeve there, it's mostly cosmetic damage, so there's no real reason to replace this. I've never seen a plug this massive on a piece of equipment before, and I think it's worth holding on to because it's vintage. So let me plug this in and turn it on. I don't need to go through any special precautions over it because the seller has already tested it and indicated that the machine actually did run for him. Let me turn it on, and we don't hear anything. That seems a little scary because, of course, you should hear a motor turning. This one doesn't do that. Instead, when you turn it on, it starts the power to the amplifier. The motors only come on when one of these controls is pressed. So if I press rewind, see that? And then there's fast forward. And here's play. Now we'll rewind again. Now I want you to listen very carefully. Do you hear this dump, 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 dump? There's a flat spot on the drive idler. And the way I could tell that was because somebody had made a mistake and had done this. They had left the stop button up. You can see that that motor is turning and that's turning. So all play does really is disengage the stop. But it also makes some electronic contacts. Next, I'm going to put in a tape. We're going to see if we can get it to run. Well, we have a tape in the machine now. The hold downs look really cool. And I'm going to see if it'll play. That's the tone control. Now I have the volume control all the way up. You can hear it's pretty noisy because of the mechanical issue. Alright, so we know that it plays. It has some hum. And it isn't running at quite the right speed, but we know that's because of the idler. Let's see how the fast forward works with a tape in it. That's pretty fast. The brakes are kind of slow. Okay, so the brakes are kind of slow on both ends. We'll see how that works when we get inside and see how the brakes are put into the machine. We know now, we've done the test, we know it does play. It has hum. That hum is constantly there, which means that it's probably a power capacitor, main filter. There are probably a few other capacitors in there that need to be changed. The tubes apparently are pretty good. I'm not going to test it for recording right now because we're going to have to do the work on the electronics anyway. And then we'll test it for recording after that's done. So, this is a good sign. This indicates that this can be resurrected. I think this is going to do very well. This concludes the first episode of the series on the Realsitc by Robuk Radio Shack tape recorder from 1961-62. Thank you for watching the video. If you liked it, please give it a thumbs up. And if you're from the United Kingdom and you know anything about the Robuk brand, please leave a comment and tell us about it. I think that not only would I like to know, but also fans who are looking at this video would like to learn more about these machines as well. We don't see a lot of British tape recorders in the United States. They just weren't imported as much as the Japanese and even the German, the Grundigs were. So it'd be nice to learn more about them. The more we know, the more we grow. And this is why I think that this is an important video to learn about this vintage machine, because it is not only very rare, but it was imported from the United Kingdom to the United States, even if it was only for 1 year, which was unusual because most of the stuff that came into the United States was from Japan. Thank you for watching the video. Please come back to ClydeSight channel for more vintage audio and tape recorder videos. Bye-bye, YouTube.